Is it recorded? All right.
So let me tell you a story. Old partner Jared. I was old cold call guy. You do sales, you do wholesales, you hit the phone, man, and you do tons of calls. Tons and tons of calls. Can't remember the movie, but you know, like 200 calls a day. I never made 200 calls a day, but easily 100 calls a day. Real old school cold selling. And I remember in early 2008, my old business partner Jared, he came and said, "We need to start a blog." I'm like, "What the hell is a blog? What are you talking about?" He's like, "Well, it's kind of like a newsletter, but it's out there everywhere on the internet." I'm like, "Why would I want to do that?" No. We had these epic arguments. He argued with me and fought for me for a couple of months before we actually came to the conclusion. I wanted to keep doing what we normally did. Like, that's not what leads to sales. That's just not what leads to sales. You do calls, you go to meetings, you fly to conferences, you press the flesh, real old school, right? Fortunately for me, he talked me into it. I was like, fine. He really just would not let go. I'm like, I'm going to do it. And we started really simple. We started just writing blogs. Really crappy website. First one was just really terrible. Made me do it every week. I did it once a week. And then something crazy happened. He's like, "You know, when we're doing this, we really should have a newsletter where people sign up for it too. So when they come to the website, they don't just see the blog. They're leaving and they're disappearing, and maybe they never come back again. So we need this little thing about our whatever." I'm like, you know, I'm down this road already. I'm like, "Whatever, Jared. How expensive is it?" Like, "Oh, it's only like $20. I'm like, "Okay, let's do it, right?" Long story short, why I'm telling you this, after 4 months of blogging, and we even were way ahead of our time. I think we even did like 2 or 3 video blogs. I gave up on it for a long time after that and went back to writing. And crazy things started to happen. We started with a list of about 20. And then after the first month, we were like 100, and then 200 the third month. Right around month 4, all of a sudden was like 1,500. Like, what the hell's going on? Like, there's 1,500 people. I don't know if you remember what 2008 was like, but very few people had blogs. It really blew up. And then we started getting phone calls and emails. Because we were operating in 2008, we were doing a bunch of wholesales when almost everybody else had gone out of business. In fact, we both had gone out of business and started a new business. So crazy things happened. CNN called us. I mean, insane things happened from this blog. Made the front page of the Detroit Free Press. It was in the Detroit News, CNN multiple times, magazines all across. I mean, it was insane, the number of things. PBS, NPR, all found us from our blog. And all our blog was, literally, I know it sounds incredibly boring, what we were doing. That's all our blog was. This is what we're doing. This is why we think it's worth it. Or if we screwed something up, man, this was terrible. Don't do this. We screwed it up. That's what happened. At the end of a year, we had over 3,500 people on that list. Now, if you think, even if you have 2,000 people on your list, do you think it's going to be a lot easier to wholesale or flip a house? Yes. And the best part about all this is it's absolutely dirt cheap. This is way better than cold calls. I'll never say don't do cold calls. Maybe you're in a spot where it's not working yet and it's slowly building and you still need to do cold calls or you still need to network and all that. But that's the story behind this. I'm a believer in it. I wasn't at first. I thought it was a complete epic waste of time. And it's getting worse. This is the future. If you haven't already noticed, your ass is being ignored because you're not aware. It's like the phone book or the yellow pages. It's what I use to start fires now. I don't even open it or look at it or read it. Everybody goes to the internet. Now, when I created my first website in 2006, it cost me $50,000. When Jared and I did our first real website, it cost us $6,000. This was in early 2008, right? And these were good prices. We finally got to India, all that stuff, good job. You can literally do this practically free now, and it's like 1,000 times better than what we did in 2008. It's ridiculous. So the future is here. I'm going to do my, hopefully I've done enough to compel you to listen and take notes, because I don't like doing PowerPoints because or pass outs, because I want you to write the shit down and go home and do it, not just, you know, whatever. So I hope that was compelling enough for you. At the end of 2 years, I had a list of over 6,000 people from all over the world where if I needed to sell a property, I sent an email. All right? It's literally that simple. And we did it with practically no money, with less than an hour most times a week putting into it. All right? If that ain't gonna sell you, I don't know what else. What else will? Free advertising and sell houses really, really fast. If that doesn't work, I don't know what will work. So, blog, website, blog. What's it mean? Same damn thing now. Used to mean something else. Used to have a separate URL for your blog and a separate website for it. No more. It's one the same thing. Now it's jeremyburgess.com/blog, toddbrittingham.com/blog, wholesaledetroit, whatever, /blog. Several reasons for that. First of all, Google basically said if you have a static page, your page sucks. That happened about a year and a half ago. We don't care about your page. You're now on second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. You're buried. 80% of the people in this entire world click only on the first page, and the vast majority of them only on the first four. Okay? So your static page and all that SEO crap, and we're gonna black hat magic your way up. Not anymore. This is where, and I like this, because you used to be able to cheat your way to the top. Now, just like the rest of real life, you gotta earn your way to the top. So you may be brilliant, but lazy, and that's not gonna get you anywhere. So for people like me who aren't brilliant, but work hard, this is like, and it's practically free, so you can do this. So when I say your blog, let's talk about URL first, because there's some smart ways to do it, and some not so smart ways. I'm gonna use me as an example. I did not do it the smart way. I don't know why Jared and I came up with wholesalemi.com. It works for me now just because I have just hundreds of posts. That was not the smart way to do it. You want a URL that accurately describes what you do. You want it to be as short as possible, but you also want it to be easy to remember. Where I recommend you start is Google AdWords has a tool. You might as well get as much free traffic from free natural searches as possible. If you ever get into Google pay-per-click, that's why. It costs money to get to the top. You might as well start with free traffic now. So you pull up the Google AdWords tool, and let's say, I'm gonna use me as an example because I know my business, or what used to be my business anyway. Homes for sale in Detroit. Now that happens that one's taken, right? But let's say it's not, right? And I go homes for sale Detroit, and I come up with some other ideas. Wholesale Detroit properties, properties for sale Detroit. And I put this in to the, and you can add all in too. They have this big open field, you separate it by a comma, and you can type all this in. Hit enter, all pops up, and it tells you how many searches a year and where the searches come from. It even tells you if they're male, female, if they have that information, what age they are, all that stuff. Now what you're looking for is some words that accurately describe your business, short as possible, but don't worry too much about short, so long as it's easy to remember. And then you compare those words with the natural traffic already occurring. Then you go to a place like GoDaddy or anyone at 1&1, wherever you want to buy your domain name at, and you start doing searches. That's how I recommend you do it. I've helped several people do this, and several of them got really lucky, and they get 15,000 searches in a year. It's accurate. It shows up. That doesn't mean all 15,000 people are going to come to your site. What that means to Google is, wow, this is actually what they do. This is the name of their URL. When they type in that search, it's exactly that search. Okay, and then you blog. It might only take you a couple months. Bam, you're in one of the first four, which is where most of the world wants to click. That's the smart way to do it. If you've already started a blog and you already have dozens or hundreds of posts, don't worry about it. The good news is most people on this planet are lazy. All you gotta do is do a blog every week. You'll get these people, trust me. They'll fall out, something new will happen, they'll go away. So, but if you don't have one or you don't have much of a presence at all, that's the way I highly recommend you do it. You might as well get the free search traffic. I mean, it's free is free. You're starting from scratch. Now, does that make sense to everybody? Because that's a really important point. I cannot underestimate how important your URL is. Give up the ego. Nobody cares it's J&J and you love your mother and your kids and all that. It's not going to bring search traffic your way. You can have that site too and do something else with it. But the URL is incredibly important. Where you're starting here, you're starting with free traffic. So long as you actually do the blog. Does that make sense?
Sure.
All right, I've made that as compelling as possible. So you got your URL. I've made several mistakes on this. I've tested it out. Don't mess around with Tumblr. Don't mess around with Wix. Any of that other crap. Don't. Dude, I committed a year and a half to these things. Does not work anywhere near as well as WordPress works. Period and report. This battle's lost. You will not win on anything else, or you'll have to work 10 times harder to win. WordPress comes in two forms. One's .com, one's .org. One, they offer your hosting for free, but it's wordpress.com/grassbandits. You know, that's what you don't want. You want the one where they give it to you, and that means you need hosting. The hosting I use is InMotion Hosting. Hosting has completely changed in the last 5 years. Hosting is practically free. Just like anything, it's a commodity. Literally, for $12 a month, they have a plan for $12 for one URL. So $130 a year, you can get unlimited bandwidth for one URL. Pay four more dollars, you get like 25 URLs. So, and that's unlimited hosting. That means literally 10 million people can click on your website at once. And in theory, in InMotion Hosting, you're not gonna get like a $25,000 bill like you used to when you had too much bandwidth or traffic coming across your website, right? So I'm gonna slow it down again and say this one more time. So when you get a URL and then you want WordPress, they give you WordPress for free. If you use InMotion Hosting, they even make it easier where you call them up and you can literally install the latest version of WordPress from your account in InMotion Hosting. I'm sure other places do the same thing. I know GoDaddy does. I know all of them they do. They make it real easy. So you don't have to be very technical to do this. It's literally clicking two or three buttons. They've made it so easy now. It's absolutely ridiculous. So you want your URL, you point your URL to where InMotion Hosting or GoDaddy or wherever else you're using, and then you install WordPress. Then it gets even better. It's embarrassing to think how much we spent making our website look good, what you would call a skin or a theme. Now they just give away stuff thousands of times better than you could ever do it. They literally have thousands of free ones. Don't like the free one? That's okay. For $35, someone will custom build you one that you will probably really, really like. Now, this might not be the end all you want, but it'll get you pretty close. So we're still at a very small number right now. To start, I wouldn't worry about it. Use the general theme that pops up. Mess around with it. The dashboard is a little confusing with WordPress. I'm just gonna say that right now. The dashboard for WordPress is a little confusing. But that's why we have YouTube. This is why I love YouTube. There's actually people on this planet that for like a penny a view on YouTube will create how-tos for all this stuff that are like 15 minutes long, and they'll do one for GoDaddy, One-in-One, InMotion Hosting, all of this stuff, and it's better than this. Like, they actually have a computer screen. They show you exactly where to click, what to do. So don't get confused. Go to YouTube. Guess what? You suck at YouTube, it's even better. At least if you use InMotion Hosting, you have 24-hour day, 7 days support. I know GoDaddy does too. That's how the industry is. Everything becomes a commodity given long enough and the price of technology drop. I had to do this. I'm not technical. It seems like I am. I actually suck at it. But you call and you go, how do I do this? Somebody will actually walk you through how to do it absolutely for free. So I hope your excuse level is about ready to evaporate, because they literally make it that easy. Even if you have a stupid question like, how do I change the banner on my dashboard? You can Google it, YouTube it, watch it to see it. Still can't figure it out? Call, they'll tell you exactly how to do it. They'll tell you the dimensions of what the picture needs to be. They'll even point you in the right direction if you don't have those dimensions to change the picture to those dimensions. It's amazing. It's so simple now. You can literally do this for $200 with something I spent $25,000 on 9 years ago. It's really crazy. There's no reason not to do it, okay? Like, okay, now I got this set up. What do I do? All I want you to worry about for the first 6 months, I don't care too much about how fancy your website is. I don't care if it's got the original picture across the top with your words, you know, like I'm wholesale in the greater Detroit area, whatever. Make it look as good as you can, but don't worry about it too much. There's two things I want you to do. You pick a day of the week. You blog. It becomes the single greatest priority in your life. All the other stuff you think is important, I promise you, it's not important. You can do everything else and fail because you didn't do this. Okay? I recommend Tuesdays or Wednesdays. I did, and I'm going to get into it. I did tons of testing. My open rates on Tuesdays are slightly better than Wednesdays, but they're really close. 10 a.m. is when the newsletter went out. I'm getting to the newsletter part. Don't get confused about that too, right? So that means Monday night or Sunday night, or if you're doing it Wednesday, Tuesday night, you write your blog. Period end report, you write your blog. I don't care if it's 3:30 in the morning, you're tired, you're giving birth to twins. Plan that shit ahead. This is the single most important thing you can do. This is like not being in the yellow pages 50 years ago. Nobody knew what was going on, okay? Even this peer-to-peer, like prepaid legal, all that, they changed the name, but all that stuff is on the internet, and most of it spreads via the internet. The internet's here, it's not going away. It's just a lot easier to do, so no excuses, okay? I want you to pick a day, every day, and you don't even look at it. You don't do anything for 6 months. For 6 months, you commit, I promise you. Commit to doing a blog a week, just one. If you want to do more, absolutely fine. But it's not, I do 3 1 week and I skip the next week. You are not going to make it. 100% failure rate. And I'm not calling anybody out. 100% failure rate with that approach. It never works. You have to set it aside once a week. It gets even better. Thanks to some people like Todd. It's back there. Raise your hand, Todd. Dennis, and a seminar I went to. You see this little camera? It's now like 3.5 years old. Give up on writing. I'm telling you right now, writing's not dead. It's on the way out. We can sit around. If you follow me on Facebook, I bitch about it. I rant all the time. People don't want to read. Their lives are busy. Go to video. Turns out for you, video's a lot easier anyway. Video is a lot easier. Now, most of my video, too, isn't very good. Some of it's even bad, what would you call bad production quality, right? Or porn, or piss porn, depending on what time of the morning I was shooting the video, how tired I was, right? That's not the point. It takes 10 times longer to write. All of a sudden, you're worried about grammar, everything else. Then, when you're writing, you have to format it. No more than 2 or 3 sentences in a paragraph, because if it looks like a big paragraph, guess what people do? They skip it, they don't read your blog post. Now you just wasted that time, right? Whereas video is highly compelling. They can watch it in the car, they can listen to it while they're doing other things. Video converts. I'm telling you, I'm gonna get to it exactly. It is crazy how well video absolutely converts, okay? So, now these little cameras now are even cheaper. It was like $250 when I bought this thing. Now, if it's like 115 and the damn thing's waterproof and you can sit it in the space, okay? You could probably pick up that same one and be just fine for $15, $20 on eBay. So this stuff is really cheap. You want something that's high definition, 720 minimum. Shoot it all in high def. okay? Here's how I recommend you do it too. There's, for those of you with smartphones, what you don't want to do is Tuesday night comes, you're going to post it and send out the newsletter on Wednesday, and you have no idea what you're going to talk about. So I recommend you have a smartphone. I personally like Evernote, but there are plenty of idea logging apps that you can try out. Evernote's the one I use, where when you think of it, you write it down. Even though I haven't done a video in almost 2 years, because of legal problems, getting my ass suit off and being broke, I still have over 50 ideas for my series, Detroit Investor TV, just sitting here. That's key, because life is busy. You do have kids, you got family, you got to cook, you got business, you got deals going bad, you know, you got everything going on. If you're waiting until Tuesday night to decide what you're going to talk about, I promise you, you're that far away from not doing the video. At least that was my personal experience and what I've seen with other people. So as you have ideas, just put it in, and then Tuesday night comes, or Monday night, or whenever you do it, that's what you talk about. Take 10 minutes, write out a few bullet points, talk it through a few times, turn the camera on, point, record, one take. I don't want you video editing, not for the first 6 months. You're not Steven Spielberg, okay? This thing is not gonna be beautiful or 2001 Space Odyssey or any of that crap, okay? That's not the point. And I will show, I'm getting to the point where I'm telling you, production quality doesn't matter as much as you think it does. It's becoming more important, but there are more important things. Yes?
Yeah, just to add to that, it's almost more important to not have that.
Yes.
It shows that you're a real person.
I will agree with Todd 100% on that. And actually, I'm going to use him as an example here in a little bit. So he did some pretty cool things with that. So shoot the video. Now, there's some goals. I'm just going to put these numbers out here. I don't want you to worry about them too much, okay? 3 to 5 minutes is the most watched video in the world, okay? If you can, whatever you're going to be talking about, accurately, succinctly, and in a conversational manner, like you're having a conversation with your best friend. That would be, I think, the goal. You're talking to the video camera, this is how I used to do it, and how I did is my best friend, I pretend I was speaking to my best friend, Jason. That's exactly how I did it. I'm like, okay, I'm not looking at the video camera, I'm speaking with my best friend, Jason. That worked for me. Maybe it's your friend, husband, wife, whatever. You want it to be conversational. You can still be more formal. I definitely went edgier. You don't have to do that. But I do think it's important that it is conversational. First of all, I don't want you worrying about it. Second of all, I want you to sound like a human being. That right now you have an advantage. You're not some big, enormous corporation that doesn't give a crap about all these people, right? Why pretend? People do this, they get business cards pretending like they're a Fortune 500 company. You haven't noticed, not a lot of people like working with Fortune 500 companies. In fact, since about 2008, I kind of hate their fucking guts. And it's a sliding scale of between Congress and Wall Street, who they hate more. So why pretend to be something that they absolutely hate? And guess what? No matter how much you pretend, you're not a Fortune 500 company. Eventually they're going to see you if they're going to do business with you anyway, or they're going to talk to you on the phone, and you can have the pretend secretary, but now they know that for $29.95, you can have a $50,000 PBX system. Nobody believes it anyway. They're going to find out who you are anyway. I say, start with you. Now, I'm not saying the crappy you. I definitely want it to be the best you, but I want it to be the real you, okay? So if you don't swear, don't swear. If you do swear, I do try and hold it back a little bit when I'm doing the videos, but not too much. You are who you are. Eventually, these people are gonna talk to you on the phone, they're gonna meet you in real life, and you need to be congruent. I want you to think about the number of people who've been screwed. These people are smart. They're advertised something like 6,000 times a day. Advertising is lying. They're lied to 6,000 times a day. They're getting really good at figuring out when you're lying, and what they do is they look for these incongruent things. So anyway, that was my recommendation. If it takes you more than 5 minutes to do the video to cover the topic, fine, don't worry about it. I think it's more important to cover what you're trying to say than not. Now, that being said, here's the reason why I want you to do it in one take. Because if you watch it, I don't watch it either. I do one take and I post it. Because if you're watching, you're like, oh, I repeated myself. Oh, look at my hair. Oh, God, I just look so shabby. What is that in the background? And here you are shooting it again. I'm telling you, it's more important that you do it every week than it is perfect. There are probably a dozen of my videos I repeat myself like 5 times. You can tell it's 3:30 in the morning. My eyes are like literally like half shut. It's almost incoherent. I still posted it. I didn't look at it. And then when I watched it the next morning, I was embarrassed. On the next video, I did better. And I think that kind of feedback is important. No, everybody else is going to tell you rah, rah, or I don't know about your hair or whatever. Shoot it the way you are, period, end report, if it takes longer. So now you know, what am I going to blog about, video blog about? Don't pretend to be something you're not. And this is where I'm going to use Todd Brittingham as an example. Todd, stand up real quick so everybody can see you, just real quick. All right, thank you. Todd decided to do 60,000 in 60 days. You've done it like one or two deals, right? Was it one, two, three? It was a small number before you did that, right? Yeah. And you want to get into wholesaling. And he did a video every day. Todd, tell everybody how that worked out for you.
I'm still here.
Yeah.
Way to sell it. Thank you.
You know, it's funny because I started doing that and I came to this meeting like about a month into doing that. And I'm sitting here, you know, kind of like tonight, you know, sitting, and Jeremy was up there speaking. And all of a sudden, Jeremy's talking. If you don't know me, I'm, you know, somewhat of an introverted person. And here I am, sitting at a meeting full of a room of investors, just like this. I just started getting into investing. And here, the guy up front is talking about me, telling everyone what I was doing. And all of a sudden, at the end of the meeting, I had 62 people trying to exchange cards with me to do that. So not only is the online presence building, you know, what you're doing, it's the offline, coming to events like this. People see what you're doing, posting on Facebook, posting on your blogs, YouTube, all this stuff. And they may only catch one or two things that you do in a month, but they catch one thing and they remember, and that, you know, starts a conversation, and then that leads to a deal, or that leads to, you know, a project, or all, I mean, there's, and that's what's amazing about this is, you never really know what direction your blog or anything is gonna take you, but it takes you there. I mean, I've had people call me out of the blue from Oregon saying, hey, I want to partner on a deal with you. You know, my wife used to live in Michigan. When we come back there, I do deals all over the country. You know, I like what you're doing, I want to work with you. You know, I wasn't blogging. Is there any way a guy from Oregon is gonna call me? You know, it just, you know, that stuff doesn't happen. So the power of this stuff, what Jeremy's talking about, it's tremendous. And, you know, I mean, I got into, after I started doing that, I started getting into wholesaling, turnkey properties. And, you know, I started selling properties to people overseas. And people would come up to me, how did you find someone overseas? They found me.
They found you.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep. And what I liked about Todd was, he didn't pretend to be anything else. He didn't come on and say, oh, I've done 500 deals. I do 10 deals a month. You know that, some of that guru crap training you get? You know, fake it till you make it. I want you to fake it till you make it without lying. I want you to be a real estate investor without lying about being. It's a subtle difference, okay? But I think it's an important one. And he said, hey, I want to make $60,000 in 60 days, and I've only done a couple deals, and I don't know how I'm going to do it. Who starts a blog that way? I was immediately intrigued. Immediately. Wait a second. Isn't that some more corporate lies, or how, look at my badass car and rims and all these women, and yeah, sign up for my program. You too can have this. He was in his car and he was recording in his car. How much more boring can you get it? But you know what? And then I met him in real life and it was the same person.
Well, the fact is, you know, we had that little $60,000 in 60 days. They make $1 in 60 days. But from that,
That's important. Thank you, Todd. He did it so well. So if you're looking for maybe a quicker start, consider. I would highly consider something like that. It worked really well for him. And I think the important thing is to be who you are in real life. It's the same on video. Don't be somebody else. All Todd's work would have been gone when he showed up if he was somebody completely different. I would have completely discounted it. I would have been not excited to meet him or anything else like that. You are who you are. I definitely want you to be the best you. I keep saying that. So if you suck or you're an asshole, you're lazy, whatever, that's got to go, right? But who you really are, I want you to be that person. So if you're a little aggressive, you're timid, you're introverted, highly technical, that's who you are. Guess what? You're going to attract other people who like that. Period, end of report. There are people that cannot stand me, would never work with me in a million years, that love Sean. There are people that love Sean, or people that hate Sean and love me. And there's Rich, same thing. Engineering background, they really like that technical. There's something for everyone. You don't need 1 million share of the market. You really need about 10 people a year to completely change your life. That's what you really need. And you could probably get 10 people a year out of 300 to 500 well-placed people from being who you are on your blog. So, all right, I'm gonna speed this up. So here we are. Your domain name at most is $15. InMotion Hosting has a plan for $6. I'm gonna recommend the $12 because you might want more than one URL. We're at $30. See how cheap this is? Okay, you can buy one of these cameras. I still use the same camera. You can buy one of these for $15 to $25 on eBay, or if you want to be a big spender, you can get one that goes to space or underwater for $110, and it's even smaller, has even more memory. So if you've got money, you can certainly spend it, but this actually works just fine. It's been highly effective. So I'm going to give you an idea on the numbers, right?
Trying to get out of your rut.
I started doing video walkthroughs before I started doing video blogging. Some of my video walkthroughs on shitty houses in Detroit have 15,000 hits. I can't make this stuff up, okay? I cannot make this stuff up. On my YouTube channel now, I have hundreds of thousands of views. It boggles my mind to this day. And every time I get on, it keeps getting bigger. I still get emails all the time, people subscribing to my channel. I'm like, I haven't done a video in forever. I have comments, asking questions. The view count just keeps going up. It didn't happen right away. So when you post them, I don't even want you to go back and look at them. Don't be obsessing. Oh, I only got 12 people who saw my video. I'm telling you, give it some time and be consistent, and it gets absolutely huge, okay? I came up with a series called Detroit Investor TV. Wildly successful, almost right out of the gate. I went from having 12 views to all of a sudden 200 views, 600 views, 1,000 views. I think I got a little lucky, to be honest, because at that time there's a lot of interest in Detroit. But I think something similar will happen with you if you're consistent about it. And if you don't know anything, that's fine. Don't pretend to know something. Just tell people what you're doing. Think of it like Facebook on the video, okay? So we're at like a really ridiculously small number, all right? So you're like, how do I build a buyer's list? That's how you do it. So before I move on to the other section, are there any questions on that? Don't be shy. Yes?
Talk about what you're doing. What you just said about Facebook posts on video, that kind of struck a chord. I know someone that's doing video marketing, YouTube marketing for sellers. So they're doing a lot of online keywords.
Yeah, it is. It is.
Would you have like a separate channel?
No.
For like sellers and one for your wholesaling? Or
nope.
Just one channel?
One.
With all kinds
one.
Of like
Here's why. I never once did a video saying I wanted to buy your crappy Detroit house. Do you have any idea how many people, even now, call, email, find me on Facebook, message me from these YouTube videos trying to get me to buy their house? It is crazy. Todd, similar experience from your video? I'm not saying you couldn't do better with a well thought out seller video. I think there's when you look at some of the people who've been really successful at it, it's probably worth at some point really thinking about it. I don't think it necessarily, it doesn't need to be on a separate channel. And when you do the video, I think it still needs to be you. So if you're following a script, you might need to adjust it to your personality, your type. I think that'd be a good idea. I wouldn't worry about it out of the gate. When you're starting from zero, you have no content out there. Nobody knows you. All right? Crudely, it's like wanting to get married on the first date, right? There's going to be some time. Probably not married, but you know what I'm saying. There's going to be some time that is going to elapse before the deal is consummated, right? So when you're first starting, I want it to be you. I want it to be out there. That could be something that's in the back of your mind that you're thinking about, planning for the future. But I think it's more important to get 6 months of videos under your blog, post it to your blog. So you post it to YouTube and then you embed it in your blog, because now you get the best of both worlds, right? They can find you through Google, or they can backtrack you through YouTube, right? And make sure in YouTube you put the links back to your blog, all right? Does that answer your question, Steve?
Yeah.
Okay. I wouldn't separate out your channels. There's a lot of people, they have seller websites, buyer websites. What I do is I have a blog and a main site and a series of squeeze pages. I think that's the easiest way to approach it. So if you're doing a paid marketing and you want to measure, which I'll get to, but you're sending out yellow letters, you're definitely going to want to push them to a particular phone number, a particular URL, so you can measure your response rate and tweak it and improve it over time. You wouldn't want to send them, especially Google AdWords too. I made that mistake early on, push them to my blog instead of a squeeze page. Google will spend your money, man. Like one of those New Jersey housewives, man. It will just burn through your credit card. So if you're going to do that, definitely send that to a squeeze page so you can measure your results. You know what you're getting. So I want to talk about AWeber real quick. So you're like, AWeber. So what do I got this blog? How do I capture them, right? AWeber, there's eye contact, constant contact. There's a bunch of them. There's even some free ones that are actually getting pretty decent. We started with eye contact and we switched to AWeber. We like AWeber. Doesn't mean you have to. What is AWeber? When people come to your blog and they read it and they go, oh, that's cool. You want to give them a way to sign up. Because if they leave, they might never come back to your website again. So on the top right hand corner, it says something better than free newsletter. Like free newsletter, get instant access to dozens of deals in the Metro Detroit area. Or I wrote a little report, free report, like, okay, don't buy here, buy here. If you're doing rehab, do this, not this. And I put it together and I said, you know, Detroit Investment Secrets, you would download your free report. Give them a little incentive, but that's not all I want you to do. And by the way, AWeber makes this really easy. You don't even have to copy and paste anymore. They have a button that says copy, you press, and it copies the code for you. And then if you don't even want to do that, get on YouTube again. They're integrated with WordPress now. You can actually add this widget. Like, I mean, it's ridiculously easy.
It's like free coins.
Yeah, it is so silly. It was so much harder before. Like I was saying, your excuses should be like almost gone, evaporated now. Put that in your blog. So now when they come to your website, oh look, you have some sort of compelling offer, deals, knowledge, follow me on my journey if you're just starting out new, something. So they could sign up. But here's the kicker, and it needs to be done right. Most of them do it wrong. Does anybody know Upworthy? Upworthy.com? Yep. Fucking hate them. Every time I go to the website, I get a pop-up that takes up the whole damn page, and I gotta click 4 times to actually watch the content you wanted me to click over through. Reason I say this, I want you to have a pop-up on your page. Here's why. 71% of our 6,000 people came from the pop-up. And you can set the pop-up. So the pop-up, if you don't know, is they come to your website. Your website sees their particular IP address, which is like your location. And one time only, After 3 seconds, it will pop up. And I don't make it too big, and I don't hide the X so you can't get around it without signing up. I make it real easy to close, and then I expand on that compelling offer. Because you only have so much space you can fit over in the top right-hand corner, about a third of the way down the page. Make sure you put it there too. Test it all over, that's where it converts the best. Now I can make an even better compelling offer. I can put a picture in. I'm not trying to sell anything. I'm trying to get them to sign up for the damn newsletter so I can talk to them, okay? That's the goal. But don't make it too big. Set it for the first time they come from that IP address. So if they want to come back, they're not annoyed like I am. I got 6 clicks to read what you're actually doing. It's kind of like the Wall Street Journal now. Now you got to buy their online. I haven't read a Wall Street Journal in 2 or 3 years now. They really shot themselves in the foot there. They're really committing to a bad business model. Don't do that. It needs to be done right. Make it easy to close. Put it in the top right-hand corner, just like, or left-hand corner, whether you're Mac or Windows. Most people are Windows. I do top right-hand corner. And it's compelling, and it's not sales pitchy, right? And if they close it, they never see it again unless they get a new laptop or they move and they got a new IP address or service provider. Then they might see it one more time. You can't help them. You know, they're going to do something like that. 71% of the 6,000 came from that pop-up. It's just some code. You copy and paste, or you can use the widget for AWeber. I'm positive eye contact does the same thing, constant contact. I don't know if the free ones do it. Maybe you sacrifice that in the beginning if you can't even scrape together $20 a month for something like that. Yes, Steve?
AWeber has, you can make a pop-up
you should. Yeah, they do. The code's right there. And here's another good thing about AWeber, why I like AWeber. There's some cheaper ones, 24/7 support again. I'm telling you, they know that to get you, they got to be cheap, they got to be reliable, and they know you're not some coding guru. You're going to have to call and talk to these people. Too embarrassed to call. Here we go again. YouTube! There's somebody who put this video together and it's got 35,000 views. It is that simple. You're gonna want that pop-up. That pop-up is really important. Maybe it's the first 2 or 3 weeks you're just overwhelmed. That's fine. Week 4, you go back and you figure out how to put that damn pop-up up. If you've got money, you have no problems. You can hire somebody to do this for like $12 an hour. It's ridiculously cheap. I'm focusing on the not having money because I get tired of hearing that I don't have any money or I don't have any time or it's not important. Well, guess what? You're all wrong. That's just not true. It's not the 1950s anymore. You've got time. Somebody can teach you. And if you got $12, somebody will do it for you too. You could probably get it done on Fiverr.com. Like it's, you know, the Fiverr.com is a place where people like, for $5, I'll do a task for you. I've seen other things like design a logo for you. There's somebody on Fiverr.com. If you're really too embarrassed to call, don't want to get on YouTube, you've got $5. Give up your latte for the day or save up for a week. Somebody on Fiverr.com will do it for you. So here's the important thing. You want that AWeber. You want that blog, that good URL. And when people come to your site, you want them, offer them an opportunity to not go away. If they want to, they can stay in the loop with you. And this leads me to my next one. Social media. Don't like it? Too bad. I mean, cry yourself to sleep. It really doesn't matter if you like it or not. You can choose to not do it, and I know one person, this person's in this room, and I'm not gonna say who this person is, who's actually done it successfully. I don't know anybody else who's not gone online and done well. And even this person has some online activity out there, but this person also has an enormous network after like, what, 15, 20 years of working. You need to be on social media. I'm not saying get on there, share Britney Spears videos or look at the Kardashians or dating. You have to be in here. And here's why it's important. The more this digital age pops open in the internet, there are more and more ways to consume content. If you're 40 plus, you'd rather get an email. I hate email. I don't sign up for anybody's newsletter anymore. I like their fan page or I follow them on Twitter. I get so many crappy emails now. The email is almost completely ruined for me. But if you're 40 plus, that's primarily the way you're going to consume. Why do I say newsletter? Statistically, 79% of the people who are going to buy your property are male and over the age of 40. So you want to have an email option. But I hope you want to be around for more than 2, 3, 4, 5 years, right? So let's think about the future. There are younger people, and Asia, I'm going to call you out on this. You do a great job on social media. You need to get your blog up, and you need a newsletter. Those are the people who have money. Why target the 21% when you're going to have the 79%? And why not do both? Here's the best part. You know what you do? Post your blog to it. That's all they're doing. It's a feed. It's a subscription. That's what they want. I want you to do some other things, and I've done some other videos, and there's some people in here who've been very successful on different approaches to how you approach social media. But all I'm talking about right now is as a feed, aggregate, whatever you want to call it, subscription service, a different alternative for them to consume your content. They can subscribe to you on YouTube. They can follow you on Twitter. They can follow you on Instagram. You can have a fan page on Facebook, whatever. I'm going to make a couple recommendations where I have seen the most value. Asia may have a different opinion. How well do you do on Instagram?
Instagram has helped me more than anything.
For her, for me, it sucks. She does it differently, though. She does lots of cool pictures with like words on it and stuff. Facebook for me has been huge. YouTube has been the biggest by far. Those are the two that have helped me out the most by far. At least do two or three. Pick the ones, try some stuff out, and all it is guess what? Another widget on your WordPress theme. It ties completely right in. It's absolutely great. They have this social media widget. It's absolutely free. Bam, there it is. Simple as can be. Can't figure out how to do it? Guess what? Call up InMotion Hosting. They'll help you do it. Go to YouTube, figure it out. And that's because you want multiple ways. Even Jeff has Facebook, at least for the time being. And has done quite, I think has done quite well with your Facebook page too, haven't you, Jeff? And he doesn't even have a website or blog. Of course, he's in a unique position than some of us. But anyway, if you're going to be dealing with, if you're in real estate now, you're in an international market. I know it doesn't seem like it. Sign up for Skype. Give them an option to contact you via Skype. It's an app on your cell phone. So they don't have to make a long-distance phone call. I know it seems petty. Like, well, I want him to spend 10 cents a minute to talk to me so I know he's serious. There are literally people on this planet that will not do a deal with you because they can't call you on Skype. That's the way it is. I recommend doing it. It's absolutely free. It costs you nothing. It's an app on your cell phone. Literally costs you nothing. You don't have to call anybody on Skype. Just be available for them to call. And whether you think you're in an international market or not, you're in an international market. The entire world is watching what's happening here. I know it seems crazy. It is absolutely true, so make sure you do that. I want to briefly go over free reports too. If you do have years of experience, you can actually do something better. I still want you to do your blog and all that stuff, but now I want you to create a squeeze page if you've got years of experience, and I want you to write a book. 40 to 50 pages, focusing on your greatest successes and your greatest failures, and you're gonna give it away to the world for free, absolutely for free. It's gonna go to the squeeze page, because you've been doing this for a while and you're somewhat successful, I want you to spend a little money to get yourself out there. Also put this same book on your blog. Giving it away is giving it away. You do this for a couple reasons, and I recommend you do this in your videos too if you have experience or you know about something really well. And by the way, this can apply if you're into sewing, haircutting, it doesn't matter. Like, you want to establish yourself as some sort of expert in the market, or if you're not an expert, up and comer. Somebody they're going to hear from all the time that they don't feel like they're going to quit and they're going to overcome obstacles. That's what you want to do. You want to establish yourself doing this, right? Write a book. If you know some shit, write a book. And put your, especially your failures. Man, I don't do this one. This one lost me this. This one lost me that. Not only do people like it, but you're really helping them out. And I can tell you, people are going to call and waste your time trying to dig you for information anyway, and then never buy from you. I can think of a much better way to save your time. Put it all out for free. Most of those phone calls go away. You just got so much more of your time back. And now when your phone rings, or you get an email, or tweet, whatever, you have more time to spend with the people who are probably more likely to spend money with you. So, and don't worry, if you don't know anything, don't worry about the squeeze page. All squeeze page is an alternate URL so you can track, because I want you to push some paid advertising to it. That's all. Probably from Google AdWords. 6 months down the road, don't worry about this if you've done none of it, but 6 months down the road, you can do the same thing, because odds are you're going to know some stuff by then. All right? Any questions on that? I promise not to mock you too much. No? No love? Yes?
I'm still hung up on what I talk about. And that experience that I have different. Who am I talking to? Also, I want to talk to buyers, I want to talk to sellers, I want to talk to investors. I mean,
no, that's a good question.
I feel like it should be, in this case, I'm talking to investors. In this case, I'm talking to sellers. But I don't know that I should want, that I want a mix to change. Do you have, does that make sense?
I understand. Here's, I haven't had to worry about this. I think it's more important to be who you are in real life on the camera. That doesn't mean we don't have marketing strategies, or we're not thinking about what we're saying, or we're not making compelling offers. So let's not confuse the two. I used to have two separate websites. I'm telling you, it doesn't work. Especially Google now highly favors constantly updated content. Incredibly high. That's really important. I see having multiple channels as an obstacle to making it easy for you, keeping it consistent. If you feel more comfortable and you feel like you can be consistent, that's fine, but I can tell you from personal experience, I haven't had to do a single seller video. Now, keep in mind, I haven't done any videos in 2 years, so I'm way behind. But I was getting calls daily to buy houses because they saw that I was talking about houses I was rehabbing, talking about houses I was selling, talking about houses I was occupying. Like, I think that kind of action, because when these people get in a situation where they've waited till the last second, or somebody died and they don't want to deal with it, or they got a nasty, ugly house they can't sell. There's probably been, in my experience, there's been several people who haven't been able to do what they say they're going to do. So when you have 40, 50 videos, and you're showing houses you've done, or things you screwed up, and things you're doing better, to me, I think that's more compelling. That doesn't mean there's not strategy and you haven't thought about it, though. Okay, remember we separated the two. I think there's value in them saying that. That would be my compelling argument to you, that there's value in them knowing how you operate, knowing the business. Now, I never got in there and told numbers. I didn't say it. I don't like it anyway. First of all, it's none of their damn business. Second of all, I always thought I was a little gratuitous myself. Now, some people differ on this. I never, like, took all this money, and I got a woman and a Ferrari. That does not appeal to me at all. In fact, if you do that, I'm running 10,000 miles the other way. I want nothing to do with you. I'm just as likely to dress like this if I had $1 million. In fact, I had $750,000 dress exactly like this. And now I have nothing. Still dress exactly like this. So to me, it matters absolutely not at all. You're going to send me the other way, right? So, but it doesn't mean that I try not to look too shabby in my videos, okay? I know that's coming from me. It may not occur to you that I actually have a lower level of dressing. That's because you usually don't see it, okay? So it may not seem like effort.
Going out close.
And
we don't want to see it naked on the screen.
None of those. Yep. And if I'm, and here's what I do. If I'm going to be with a seller, if you go back and look at my videos, there's very few. This is the one thing I'm really sensitive about. Because it does, not so much now, but in the beginning, it does kill deals. All my Navy tattoos. I don't regret them at all, but the reality is, they kill deals, okay? Yes, sir.
You know Brian Setzer, the rockabilly artist?
No.
Stray Cats?
Okay, yeah.
He always says the best advice his father ever gave him was, don't get a tattoo where the judge can see it.
Yes. Long sleeve shirts, unless your judge drags you in and never mind. Unless you don't have that opportunity because they didn't give it to you. But no, that is excellent advice. I would put on nice pants. I didn't wear slacks, that's not me, okay? But I didn't show up in my holy Carhartts like you might see at my house. I put on a clean pair of blue jeans, boots, button-up shirt, and that's how I went. I was out working in the yard, I hadn't showered, I went and showered. I did do, you know, so now some people like dressing nicer. James Danley does. Nothing wrong with that. He likes looking good. Then look good. What I'm saying is if you're not naturally inclined to do it, so you're probably not going to do it consistently. You want to turn over a new leaf and look really snazzy? I'm on board, right? What I don't want you to do is something that you can't stick to. And then when you show up at that moment, they think they're getting this. And now you're in a suit and tie with the Ferrari you rented because that's what so-and-so told you for $5,000. And now you, it's not going to work. So does that answer your question? That was a long-winded way of answering your question. Why not try it? That's better advice. Try it for 6 months. And then if you didn't try something else for 6 months, if you already think you can do it consistently. So, all right. Any other questions? Because I want to briefly cover sellers. Because sellers is a lot easier than you think it is. And this is actually where most of your money is going to go. Some people are going to be pissed at me. Everybody good? Okay. How do you find sellers? If you're just starting out, I pretty much want you to completely ignore the MLS right now if you are investing in Metro Detroit, okay? So for YouTube, for the rest of the world, this might apply to you, but I'm talking mostly about Metro Detroit. There's more interest and there's inventory, unless you have really long-term established contract or relationships with people, or you can work it full-time. There are people who do it very successfully, but that's still not where they're getting all their deals from right now. When you're starting out, you have a problem. You don't know what you're doing. You sound like you don't know what you're doing. Why would any real estate agent mess with you? Because they get 10 phone calls a day about how you buy 10 houses a month and spend all this money, but your lingo doesn't match, your attitude doesn't match, your response rate doesn't match. They hear this all the time. You want to know why you're ignored? First, you're given a bad script. Second, even if you're telling the truth, you just had 9 assholes before you ruin it for you. All right? That's a tough way to break in. I want you to put that on pause, or at least not make that the main part of your deal strategy. I want you to go directly to private sellers. Get them before the agent gets there. Guess what? They're not sophisticated. They probably bought 1 or 2 houses their entire lives. And the real estate agent did it most of the time. They're not going to probably catch your mistakes. Or at least if you're making a mistake here and it never goes anywhere, you didn't blow it with this entire, you know, depending on what realty outfit you're going at, where they go and they go. I'm sure they do this, right, Joe? They get together. This idiot called me today. What was his name? Oh, yeah, he called me too. Don't think that doesn't happen. And now there's social media, Twitter. This idiot calling him open. What I'm saying is it's easier to get information out now, and so it's harder to recover from mistakes. Plus, it's not as easy to do as it used to be. So here's what I want you to do. First, if you have no money and lots of time and have access to a printer, I want you to do a flyer. I don't want you to make it yellow. Everybody makes it yellow or green or red. They've been doing it so many fancy colors now. Guess what stands out? White. You probably have white paper in your home. Nothing fancy. You can do it at the library. You print a flyer. It's got your URL. It says something simple like, I buy houses. And then I think this is really important. Can close in 7 to 10 days. Because if it's a deal, you can do it in 7 to 10 days. Don't promise sooner, because I promise your title company will screw you that one time. And if they have to close it quick, and it's your first deal, you may want to talk to somebody here in RDI or something like that. And here's the thing where I don't like most of these courses, okay? We make money solving other people's problems, not fucking up their life by not doing what we say we're going to do, okay? I take this really seriously. If you say you're going to close on a deal, there are legitimate reasons not to. And that needs to be discovered fast. So I like putting 7 to 10 days, because if you have a list, you know people in RDI, you attend meetings, and you have a real deal. I don't care if you don't have money, you will find money if it's a real deal. If it's a real deal, I don't care if you don't have a buyer, you will find a buyer if it's a real deal. Guess what? Nobody wants your shitty 20% deal. They don't. They're going to tell you to pack it. You come with a 65% deal minus rehab, that's a real deal. In this market, you can probably even squeeze by with 70, because things are doing so well, somebody might pay 75 right now. I don't like to bet on that, because you could always get bit, but those are your margins. You're looking for 30 to 35% margins from the value. 7 to 10 days, you can do that. Keep it real simple. Point into your website and a phone number. They're going to see other options to follow you on your website. They're going to call you. This method sucks, because I want you to take this flyer to your target neighborhood, and hopefully they don't have a bunch of rent-a-cops driving around, and start putting them on doors. Every time you see grass is slightly overgrown, put it on the door. Looks like it's vacant, put it on the door. Roof's looking tired, put it on the door. This is terribly, terribly ineffective. You're probably going to have to put out $200 or $300 to get a single phone call. But there's no cheaper way to get a great deal if you have no money and lots of time. Because nobody who has any money is going to do something this ineffective that takes this much time. Four of my coaching students have found great deals doing this, where they've made tens of thousands of dollars. So I promise you, I don't want you to do it forever. This is for the people. I do not have money, but I've got enough gas to put in the car, and I can print this stuff off at home, and I can, if it looks like the house is distressed, and here's why I want you doing it, because when you go and you put this on the ugly house or the overgrown house, neighbor's going to come out and talk to you. Oh, hey, no, I'm Judy. I'm Jeremy. I'm looking to buy some more houses in this area. I really like this area. I want to do some rentals or some flips, and oh, here, let me give you a flyer. I want you to do both. They're going to come talk to you. That's what I want you to do. I don't even care if you have a business card. Oh, let me give you one of my flyers, right? Pick an area, go do this. It absolutely works, and it absolutely sucks, okay? I want you to do this for enough times, preferably one deal you can make $5,000 on, or $2,000 or $3,000, and you don't need to live on the money. Here's the important part. If you want to get out of this loop, don't spend the money. Because here's what's even better. Is that, trust me, this gets old real quick, but it absolutely does work. After that, or if you have money now, here's what you do. Direct mail. Believe it or not, you can go on the internet and buy lists. And it's getting cheaper and better and more targeted. These lists will target things like free and clear homes. Landlords, that's where they target. Tax information is different from the physical address on the tax records. They sell probate lists. They sell bankruptcy lists. Or you can market directly to the people. Or one of the best campaigns I ever did was I actually directly marketed to bankruptcy attorneys. I still get calls on that from 6 years ago, those letters. I mean, it's absolutely crazy. They keep these things forever. Typically, depending on how many you buy and what you negotiate, anywhere from 5 cents a name and address to 10 cents a name and address. They usually have a minimum. Some are 200, some are 300, some are 400, depending on how you use. I don't think one's particularly better than the other. I think they're all accessing pretty much the same data. So just go to Google, type in list services, start calling, checking, see what the prices are. See if you can't find somebody you like working with, right? A lot of people do the free and clear ones too, so you might want to try something different, but there's nothing wrong with doing free and clear. Here's the best part. Even if you don't have a lot of money, you can still do this if you got a little bit of discipline, okay? You save up, you buy a list for $200 or $250. You have a couple thousand names on it for free and clears in your target area. You give them the zip code, right? While you're watching TV at night or watching YouTube videos or whatever, take a sheet of paper out. You're writing your seller letter. Dear seller, my name is so-and-so. I'm looking to buy houses in your area. Here's a little bit about me. You write this out. Now, I don't want you to do this forever either, but this is a good start. when your budget for direct mail marketing is incredibly small, you need a better response rate than the industry average, which is 1 to 2%, or you're not going to make it. You're not going to get the results. You write a letter out by hand, you put it in a real envelope, and don't just get the American flag stamp. Get something like Goofy or Birds or something, you know, like you're actually getting a letter. Oddly, we've kind of come full circle. It went from, like, before 2009, I ignored most of my mail, and I mostly paid attention to my email, and now I'm kind of back the other way. I pretty much ignore my email, and I pay more attention to my mail. It's been a while since anybody's written me. You get a birthday card, you get excited about that. My point is, when you do it this way, they're going to open it up. Yeah, yes, there's some things you do want to say and you don't want to say, but I don't want you to worry about that too much. I want you to be authentic. You're looking to buy houses in this area. I like bringing some of my personal life into it. I like having some. I like people knowing what I am interested in, because the more things you're interested in real life, not just pretending, the more likely you are to find some sort of connection. That's how I have 800 of the weirdest ass, craziest people friends on Facebook. Okay. Because I have a wide range of interests. That's why I've got communists on one end, anarchists on the other one, atheists, Christians, Muslims, even some astrology people, dog rescuer people that kill dogs and eat dogs and get on and taunt my rescue people that they would eat a dog. I have it all, right? God. It's because I have wide, varied interests. So I have multiple connections to people. I don't want you to make these interests up. Now, I'm not saying share your whole life either. I keep a lot of stuff private. Probably doesn't seem like it, but I actually do. And believe it or not, I filter myself, which should be relatively terrifying to you. So I want them to know you're a real person. When you're writing this letter, do not pretend to be a Fortune 500 company. Okay? You can also do postcards. If you're on a very small budget, I would rather you do 10 handwritten letters a night. So if you have $100 for that month, you're going to write 10 a night, you're done in 10 days, and then for the next 2 or 3 weeks, you're going to get some phone calls, work those leads. Next month comes, you have another $100, you're going to do the same thing. You're just working down that list you bought, okay? I know this seems slow at first, but if you don't have any money, this is how you break in. All it takes is the one deal to get. Yeah.
I did exactly what you're saying.
Speak up, nobody can hear you.
You know, hi, blank. My name is Steve Londo. I want to buy your house at blank. Please call me at phone number. Please call my name. I printed those out on my printer, 50 of them. And I just wrote in their name and address, wrote the name and address on the envelope, stamped it in a minute apiece. So it was about an hour. I had 50 letters. I get a 25% response rate.
Yep. Isn't that amazing? Industry standard is 1 to 2%. If you've got money and your list is huge, I say go with a postcard. Because you're not going to want much more than a 1 or 2% response rate if you're mailing 5,000 people, okay? But if you have to buy a small list and you don't have a lot of money, you need your response rate to be higher, okay?
Jerry,
so, yes, sir.
I tried doing something similar to that with the tax foreclosure list. I went to the houses physically.
I never recommend that.
Well, yeah. I wrote out a note saying I'm interested in buying your house, put it in an envelope, and I taped it to the door. And we had a phenomenal response rate.
You did well?
Third.
See?
So
I don't know if I'd recommend that, although he's got gumption, it's probably the beard. Remember, something to consider when you're knocking on somebody's door and it's a distress thing, it's distress for a reason. These people are not in their right state of mind. Something has happened in their life, loss of job, divorce, a death in the family, and they've been ignoring a problem for a long time, so just be careful. But two-thirds, and that's crazy, 66%, that's amazing. So you can do that too, especially if it's a nicer neighborhood. Were you doing that in Pontiac?
No, I was not doing it in Pontiac.
Okay.
Yeah. We did it in Warren.
Okay.
And I got a list of property tax foreclosures up in the Port Austin area, and I drove to Port Austin, and I went to every one on that list.
Good. And great response rate, right?
Great response rate.
There you go. So that's how you want buyers to find you, and you want sellers to find you. All right? Now, I did this for I was trying to keep the excuses down to a minimum, where I said less than $200 a month. You can do this on $200 a month. And all you need is one deal, and then you can completely change the way you do deals. Because in the beginning, your time is relatively worthless because you have no money. So you spend it. When you have money, your time becomes a lot more valuable. So you spend more money. It's fine when you have money to spend money to make money. I do encourage you to track everything. I think it's really important. If you can't do this in the beginning with your direct mail having a separate phone number or a separate URL to push them to, that's fine if you only have one site. Like you're really, really tight, make sure when you're talking to me, ask, how did you hear about me? Because where I made the biggest mistakes in marketing was not being able to follow whether it was working or not.
Ain't that right?
You want to know how they found you, and you want to tie that lead to money in your bank account. Because then it becomes really easy to justify spending money on something. When you don't know where something's coming from, and I've spent tens of thousands of dollars not knowing where it was coming from, because I didn't know any better, and I'm stupid sometimes, or often, depending on who you ask. Gina left the room, so sometimes. tracking is important. Separate phone numbers are important. Separate URLs, especially when you're paying. It's fine when you're doing YouTube videos for free. Push them to the blog. That's fine. If it doesn't cost you any money, push them to the blog. If you're spending money, you push them to a squeeze page. And every campaign has a different squeeze page. So you know what your response rate is, so you can tie those dollars you spent to dollars in your bank account. And then if you're like, how do I get bigger? Once you've tied dollars here to dollars in your bank account, how you get bigger is you put more dollars in over here. And you can feel confident doing that because you know if I send out 400 letters, I make $30,000, and it costs me $1,500 to send out that many letters. How many times should I do this? As much time as I have time for. Really easy to make that decision over anything else. I'd also caution against any traditional forms of media. You are not a brick and mortar business. I don't want to see on a billboard. I don't want to see in a magazine. I don't want to see in a newspaper. They spend your money like you're a Fortune 500, and you're not. Fortune 500 companies are literally just wasting money on advertising because somebody at the board said, we're going to spend this much on advertising. Well, guess what? You are your board. Most of that shit doesn't work, especially for a business this small. There are some exceptions. Some cool kind of radio, online radio podcast things I've seen do very well. There's another one, Real Estate 411. They have an interesting model where they're having investors or professionals pay them to come on their radio show, and then they make it sound like a normal radio show. There are a few exceptions to that, and it is a normal radio show you can listen to. They buy an hour on regular radio. But I'm telling you, the numbers are really small. You're far more likely to succeed on the internet. And be careful how you spend your money and make sure you track it all and send letters directly to sellers. That's all I have for you. Do you have any questions on that? For now, forever hold your peace.
What's that number? Like you said, all right, if you don't have any money, you know, this is the time things that you can do to minimize your costs. What's your, see, you do have money, what's the number look like? $5,000-$10,000 a month?
It depends on your lifestyle. Like right now, we've been living on like $650 a month for a long time, right? That might not even make your rental payment in Royal Oak, right? I think it's how much money you have left over and really how committed you are to it. Everybody's risk tolerance is the same. I'm the kind of guy who jumps in. I will spend down to the last dime because I know I'll make something happen. But if you have a spouse who really doesn't like you, like, that seems risky, the market, it might be, you might want to start smaller and show your spouse some results first. Especially if you've done it in the past and failed. Like, you, if you signed up for all the peer-to-peer network marketing stuff and failed, they might have a reasonable argument why they might not want you dropping $1,500 on a campaign, and they're worried about keeping the lights on or paying the rent. So it's really personal. I think, like, if I had an extra $400 a month, I would skip and go straight to direct mail. I wouldn't drive around, right? If I had $400 a month I could put out every month, and I had a vehicle from point A to point B that I can get there reliably, and I had 10 hours a week that I could reliably work this, I would skip forward to that if you're really busy. And if you're incredibly busy, already doing another job, some things automatically go out the window. Like, it's gonna be really, if you're working 80 hours a week, it's gonna be really hard to drive neighborhoods and pass out flyers. Mm. Like, time is really limited. So, does that answer your question?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I think one thing you should touch on is, you know, once they have that person, you know, the contracts and the rest of it.
Oh, thank you. Joe, I love you right now.
Hopefully most of the time.
So I'm not going to beat you up. Or get beat up. We were supposed to fight tonight. So far it hasn't happened. I'm probably pretty happy about that. Okay, so let's go over purchase and sale agreements. I did gloss over it, and I have it written down, and I forgot to say it. All right? Fuck you and your weasel clauses. Are you in the I don't want to do and I want 16 ways out of real estate business? Or are you into I want to tie that damn thing up and do deals business? You want to kill a deal with me? Show me 16 weasel clauses. You know what I do with that thing? Right in the shredder. What do you think this seller is? And like, oh, and you can close this in 7 to 10 days? Yeah, but here's my 17-page Fannie Mae addendum and the different ways I'm going to get out of this. Right? There's no magic PA either that's going to get it signed by the seller. Oh, I need this PA. If I just had this purchase and sale agreement, they'll automatically sign it because it was done by so-and-so and all that. No. You need two at most outs. If it's financed, if it's going to be financed, you need that clause. You never know what's going to happen. They say yes the day of closing, they turn you down. Your private lender falls through because either you screwed up or they screwed up or you didn't have a good enough relationship, or sometimes things just go bad. I thought I was going to have money back. I didn't. Whatever. And an inspection clause. And here's what I talk about, a little bit about the morals of this business. Some people feel like they're taking advantage of people. You're not. These people didn't solve their problems. They're not going to solve their problems until you show up. That's why they're in that situation. They're not thinking clearly. This is, you don't look down on them. I'm sure we've all been there. I've been there. I mean, about a year ago, it was pretty rough for me. I was having a hard time getting things done and following up on things. We kind of all end up in these situations in life where we let problems go too long, and now we just, there's no more time to deal with the problem. That's where you come in, and you, it's great because you get to be the hero, even though they don't treat you like it, and you get to make money. You're solving a problem the traditional market can't solve. Here's what I can't stand. Do not tie that property up for 60 days. Do not do it unless they have 60 days. And here's my thing. I tied up for 5 days. If I know I can't get any interest in it in 5 days, I let them go. I think you have a responsibility not to fuck with these people's lives anymore. Whatever they're going through sucks. And they might really, really, really need that money. So when you got that course that said tie it up as long as you can or option it or whatever, remember these are people's lives, okay? These are people's lives. I do 5 days. I think 7 days is acceptable if they have enough time. Always ask. If they need something done right now and you can't do it, say, you know, I don't know if I can do it. There's nothing wrong with saying, I don't know if I can do it. Can I tie this up for 1 day? They'll tell you no, fuck off. They'll tell you yes, do it. Just be honest, all right? So you need two clauses, the regular MLS purchase and sale agreement for the state of Michigan is perfectly acceptable. Has a bunch of stuff in there you don't need. Maybe they've seen it, whatever. You can go buy one, but read through and get rid of all the weasel clauses except for inspection for 5 to 7 days, you can't figure out we're going to buy the house in 7 days, you can't do, you're not going to do the damn deal. Odds drop real low. So don't do these to these people. And financing, especially if you're going to get financing. If you're going to use financing, tell them you're going to use financing. It's really simple. Well, how do you buy this thing? Well, I work with private lenders. They go, what's private lenders? Oh, well, banks don't like lending money on deals like this because we have to work too fast. So I have friends and family and colleagues that lend me the money so we can close it faster. Now, once you get good, which hopefully isn't too long, you thought I've been living in Detroit too long, once you improve your ability to close deals and operate in real estate instead of get good, a lot of times I will waive all. I'll waive it all, and that's how I'll get the deal. What? No inspection, no nothing? Heck yeah. I'm in the deal getting done business, not the weasel the fuck out of wheel deals business, okay? I want you to really think about that. Quit worrying about weaseling your way out of deals. If you don't like the deal, don't sign the contract. If you can't find something wrong with the house or right with the house in 7 days, that's an acceptable period of time. You haven't screwed up their life. Your morals are high. Is that what you're talking about, Joe?
Well, I mean, just in general, I mean, someone might go out there, get all the leads in the world, and show up and not have any contracts.
Yeah, you're going to want a PA when you show up to the house,
yeah.
Purchase and sale agreement. Your goal is to get them to sign it before you leave. I don't like doing really hard closes, but the contract's coming out. When I give them an offer, I'm writing the offer and putting it in front of them, and I'm shutting up after I present it. That's just basic one-on-one negotiation.
Well, if you know anything about real estate, you should be able to catch 95% of the problems in a house on a walkthrough.
And if not, hire an inspector. That's why I said 5 to 7 days. If you don't know, put it under contract anyway. If you're close, don't be like, oh, we're at 10% off market value. No. But if you're like at 27, 28, maybe you're wrong about something. Maybe you can talk them down a little bit more. Maybe there's not as much rehab as needed. It's okay. It's okay to do that. There's a lot of... And here's why you also want to do this, too. There's people who take these courses, and they go out, and they put all these houses under contract, and they make us all look like assholes. Trust me, it's hard enough to do it the right way anyway. We don't need these people doing it. And I would highly recommend that you be ethical and moral about it, and, I mean, get into the deal, not get out of the deal. Go to the house with a PA, with a pen, make an offer if you like the house. Before you go to the house, you should have a pretty good idea of what the house is worth when it's fixed up. Okay? Then when you're walking through the house, you're subtracting from that number. Creating a report. Don't do the deal if it doesn't make sense. I recommend 35%. It should probably be a minimum of 30%. There might be a few exceptions, Royal Oak, Birmingham, where it might make sense to go up several more percent. But in general, you need 30 to 35% off to buy the house, minus rehab. Okay? Is it hard to get these deals?
Yes.
Yes. What? And this is something I want to say, like, oh, it's just so hard to get these deals. Why would you sell a beautiful house, you can stay forever, and you can afford to put it on the market and wait forever, for 35% less than what it's worth? You don't. Otherwise, you're stupid. Okay, that's not the way it works. Okay, and these people don't put up flags like I'm depressed because my wife divorced me, or I lost my job and I can't find another one, and now I'm going to lose my house, but I'm too embarrassed to talk to anybody about it. You know, these things they're hard to find, mostly because it's embarrassing shit. Okay, so be a little tactful when you're speaking with them too, and realize that it's supposed to be hard, or everybody would do it. That's why almost nobody does it. So, welcome to the team of people who do it.
Can I just float one thing
yeah.
out there? Don't float around shitty deals. That's the worst thing about those sailors. Oh, my God.
Well, yeah, I could go into that rant, too.
You make sure it's a deal before you, like, send it out there. Like, find another person in this room who can verify, like, hey, that's a nice deal.
If you want to be a wholesaler, I specifically spend most of this time talking about wholesaling. You'd also apply it to flipping. A lot of it to landlording, too. You know what you get paid to do as a wholesaler?
Find deals.
Let me give you some examples of things that aren't deals. Hey, Jeremy, I got a deal. Give me a call. I better know you. I better know you for a long time. Would you just, do you think you get paid for that email and then I call you? If I know you, that's cool. Like, I know you really well and we've done deals, I'll give you a call. Otherwise, that's not what you do. I got a house for sale in Detroit, $30,000. Let me know if you're interested. Really? No address? No pictures? Nope. Delete.